Warning! This video is not for kids, and in fact contains a great deal of downright unladylike profanity. Warning number two! This video series analyzes a Christian media franchise from a queer, Jewish, leftist, and atheist perspective. If you think that's gonna make you angry, I'd advise that you just not watch this. Go do something that relaxes you. Just take the day. Good? Good. Hello, my name is Aaron Lockman, and if you, like me, like to talk to tomatoes.
If a squash can make you smile, if you like to waltz with potatoes.
Hang on, did we ever actually see a potato? I don't think we did. I think we saw a squash on one occasion, but I don't think we ever saw a potato.
Why won't you let me waltz with potatoes, Bob?
VeggieTales is a Christian media franchise that primarily consists of a series of direct-to-home video episodes released from 1993 to 2015. Each one starred a cast of limbless vegetables and was usually shorter than an hour, based around a specific theme, and split into several vignettes. Hosted by the irritable and tightly wound Bob the Tomato, as well as his goofy, dim-witted husband, Larry the Cucumber, the vegetables and occasionally fruits in question would reenact Bible stories, parody popular pop culture properties, and impart to their kid audience various moral and Christian lessons, like standing up to bullies, telling the truth, and,
My name is Joshua, and God has given us this land!
Manifest destiny? Put a pin in that, we'll come back. For a time, VeggieTales was massively popular, and not just with the evangelical Christian crowd. For much of the 2000s, it was a massively successful, vertically integrated thing. There were VeggieTales video games, movies, merchandise, and though that popularity and ubiquity seems mostly to have faded in the mainstream, VeggieTales still evokes an awful lot of nostalgia for my generation, and well, hang on. It's still going! The last direct-to-video episode was in 2015, but there's a streaming series released from 2019 to 2022, made by a lot of the original creative team, called The VeggieTales Show, that takes place in a theater, Muppet Show style. Who knew? There are also two Netflix series, VeggieTales in the House and VeggieTales in the City, but I don't so much consider those canon VeggieTales, so much as I consider them conclusive evidence that I cannot die, because if I could die, these images would have killed me. As you might have guessed, I was obsessed with VeggieTales when I was but a wee babe. I had all the VHS tapes and DVDs. I drew little VeggieTales cartoons. I even distinctly remember a period in second grade where I refused to walk like a human and instead just hopped around like I was a sentient piece of asparagus. But here's the thing. Looking back, it seems abundantly obvious to me that VeggieTales is, well, it's Christian propaganda, right? I mean, the structure of the show is pretty openly attempting to instill morals and values in children that are directly derived from Christian doctrine. And as an adult Jew, it behooves me to be extremely wary of the Christian propaganda I've ingested in the past, as well as the Christian propaganda that those around me have ingested. Considering its outsized impact on mainstream culture compared to literally any other Christian children's entertainment, I would assert that VeggieTales absolutely merits a closer look. Now, I have seen a great deal of recent veggie journalism that details the story of Big Idea Productions, the company that makes VeggieTales. In particular, this video by the YouTuber SaberSpark and this podcast episode from the podcast Preach do a great job of taking you through the history of the company and VeggieTales' pop culture impact. But that's been done, and besides, I'm not a history guy. I'm not even a herstory guy, hashtag NB writes. I'm a story guy. And I have yet to see someone go through the entire VeggieTales catalog and evaluate each one as a piece of entertainment. So I'm gonna do that. This was a good idea. I feel good about it. Now, before we get started, some ground rules. I will only be discussing the main line of VeggieTales videos that ran from 1993 to 2015. If I feel like it, I might do a video about the two theatrically released movies and or the 2019 series. We will not be discussing any other ancillary media. That means we're not talking about the video games, the live shows, the short-lived NBC TV show, and we're sure as hell while not talking about the Netflix version. I already see these character designs in my nightmares every night. I have no desire to introduce that suffering into my waking life. As I go through the series, I will primarily examine each VeggieTale by asking three fundamental questions. One, is this entertaining? And if so, how did it get there? Two, does my queer, Jewish, leftist, atheist ass agree with the moral of these Christian stories? Could I show this to a kid in good conscience? And number three, of course, most importantly, do the songs slap? So, without further ado, let us preheat the oven to 400 degrees, sprinkle some olive oil and salt and pepper and garlic over the assembled ingredients, and plunge headfirst down the produce aisle.
There's 100 tiny monsters jumping right into your jammies.
What are you gonna do?
I'm going to call the police.
Junior, you fucking snitch! Where's God When I'm Scared establishes a great many of the things we will come to expect from the VeggieTales formula. We open with Bob and Larry on the countertop, who have just received a letter from a kid who has a problem, as they do in every episode. Larry offers some goofy advice, and Bob tells a story that helps out the kid. First, we have the story, Tales from the Crisper. Junior Asparagus watches a scary movie and can't fall asleep, but thankfully, Bob and Larry show up by, crashing through the ceiling? That's coming out of the security deposit. Anyway, they help Junior by telling him that God is bigger and stronger than all the monsters on TV, and that God made Junior and cares about him, so nothing's gonna harm him, which, okay. Put a pin in that, we'll come back. They also invite famed celery character actor Phil Winkelstein.
Actually, my name is Phil Winkelstein.
Who plays Franken-Celery in the movie Junior was watching to crash through the ceiling as well. Phil apologizes for scaring Junior with his performance, which makes me wonder if I could just, like, call up Toni Collette's agent and get her to, like, come to my house and apologize for Hereditary. You probably have to have some pull in the industry. Anyway, they all sing the absolute banger, God is bigger than the boogeyman, and Junior falls adorably asleep.
God is bigger than the...
This one is very fun right off the bat. While the animation is extremely rudimentary, this is still very impressive for 1993 and rivals some of the stuff that Pixar was doing around that time. Because these characters don't have limbs, that means that most of the emotions come through the face, namely the eyes, the eyelids, and the mouth. And so they come off as a great deal more alive and expressive than most other early computer animation. In particular, Larry's goofiness and Bob's neuroticism are emphasized through visuals just as much as dialogue. The moral here is obviously that you don't need to be scared of the monsters in your closet, because God is bigger than all of them and he's taking care of you. My problem with it isn't even that I don't believe in a literal God, it's just that I don't think this advice would have been helpful to me as a child. I believed in God when I was Junior's age, I even watched this exact VeggieTale, and it did not help. I can relate to Junior here. I was a very fragile kid, to the point that relatively tame stuff like not two, but three of the VeggieTales we will be covering sent me crying into the other room and gave me horrible nightmares. My mother rightfully wouldn't let me watch anything, even approaching the idea of having the faintest twinkling of considering encroaching on the general vicinity of scary. And I was still terrified all the time! So even Dad Asparagus's non-religious solution at the end of the short,
I do think we should be a little more careful about what we watch on television,
did not help me. I didn't stop being scared of falling asleep until, My point is that I don't actually have a better moral that might actually help a small child be less scared at night. If you have an idea for dealing with the monsters under my bed, drop a comment. Our second story is called Daniel in the Lion's Den. And by the way, I love this little sequence here where there's like a title screen with a fancy serif font over a black background, like it's the opening of an Oscar bait film, and it says, starring Archibald Asparagus as King Darius, as if he's Patrick Stewart or somebody. It's great stuff. Anyways, Daniel, played by Larry, is a Jewish guy living in Babylon, and he gains favor with the king after explaining a dream to him. The king's three wise men super don't like this, so they hatch an evil scheme to get rid of Daniel in this all-time musical number that has to be the most iconic thing in VeggieTales history. They con the king into passing legislation that lets them throw Daniel into the lion's den, expecting him to be eaten, and Daniel, understandably, gets pretty scared. But God protects Daniel! Somehow! And by the end of the story, Daniel and the lions are just, like, super tight.
See you guys later! Thanks for the pizza!
We had pizza?
We didn't get pizza.
I like to imagine that Daniel and the lions spent the whole night, like, gaming, and there's, like, pizza boxes and soda cans and chip bags everywhere. And by the way, who the hell are these two ladies in the corner here in the first scene? They literally just stand here the entire time. The asparagus one doesn't talk at all, and the pear has one line where she calls Daniel a loony, and then they leave and are neither seen nor heard from again, which honestly, iconic. All I really have to say about this one is that, Daniel is a victim of religious persecution, right? He is summarily executed for the crime of being Jewish, although since it's VeggieTales, and this is an important note, he's arrested for praying to God, because VeggieTales doesn't like to use the words Jews or Jewish. But putting this aside, is it super responsible to tell a victim of religious persecution that everything will be fine because the lions just straight up won't eat you? I would argue this is a bit of a yikes. Political officials gunning for you because of your religion or ethnicity is not the same thing as monsters under your bed, and this episode treats them as equivalent. But to be fair, that idea is a bit complex for a 5-year-old, and we're trying to strike a tone here. Point is, this is not the first instance of Big Idea Productions bumping up against the limitations of using ancient stories to tell kids modern lessons. At this point, I do have to give a quick shout out to the work of Kurt Heinicke, the man responsible for a good chunk of the music on VeggieTales. The music is one of the main reasons VeggieTales is so fondly remembered, and rightly so. One thing to notice here is that Heinicke did not write any of the songs in this first video, but he did arrange all of them. And if you analyze the chords or play them yourself, you'll notice they're not that complex. God is Bigger Than the Boogeyman and Oh No, What We Gonna Do are iconic specifically because of the instrumentation. Heinicke manages to make both of these good songs great by just messing around with percussion and adeptly layering layers upon layers of instruments on top of each other. And this creates some really dynamic moments. VeggieTales creators Mike Naraki and Phil Vischer nabbed this guy from their church choir, and he absolutely knocked it out of the park. Which brings us to the relevant question. Do the songs slap? As we've covered, God is Bigger Than the Boogeyman slaps. The Water Buffalo song only kind of slaps, but as the seminal silly song with Larry.
The part of the show where Larry comes out and sings a silly song.
I have a great deal of affection for it. My only real criticism is just the very obvious plot hole that, like, not everyone has a water buffalo. I mean, where the hell is my water buffalo? Why the fuck don't I have a water buffalo? The King Darius suite, Fear Not Daniel, and You Were in His Hand are really all variations on the same theme, and it slaps, even though it's a bit repetitive. Oh No, What We Gonna Do slaps so hard it's not even funny. We've Got Some News, however, does not slap. It's interesting, the music in Daniel and the Lion's Den has a classical, old-timey Gilbert and Sullivan sort of feel that doesn't adapt very well to digital instruments, but definitely gives this short the structure of a musical, which is really cool. Where's God When I'm Scared? Definitely has a few kinks and growing pains. Some awkward cinematography where characters are framed weirdly, and more than a few awkward silences.
You wanted to see me?
But by contrast, the humor is extremely on point. Highlights include Bob and Larry just arguing with Junior about whether or not Junior is scared, and he keeps insisting he's not, and they just keep being like, okay, all right, okay, yeah, all right, sure. The wise men critiquing each other over their lion puns as they leave Daniel to die.
Mine was funny. Yours was goofy. Lions are gonna lie at you?
This wise man trying to carry Daniel by, like, balancing him on his spiky head, and meanwhile Daniel's just chatting away amiably. And of course, Bob doing his annoyed face whenever Larry does something dumb. Overall, this one is extremely solid, providing a great foundation for future VeggieTales to build upon and improve.
You know that in love we can forgive. It is the only way to live.
After a countertop scene in which Bob and Larry discuss a question from a viewer about forgiveness, God Wants Me to Forgive Them opens with the story of the Grapes of Wrath, a loose parody starring four literal wrathful grapes and borrowing only the names and general hillbilly vibe from the Steinbeck novel. Ma, Pa, Tom, and Rosie Grape crash their old-timey automobile into the front yard of none other than Junior Asparagus. They proceed to insult his appearance twice, prompting the entrance of Dilf Asparagus, sorry, Dad Asparagus, who explains to them that insulting people is wrong. They apologize, Junior reluctantly accepts, and then the grapes insult him again! They apologize again, but Junior is understandably reticent to forgive them twice. At this point, however, it's not only Dad Asparagus who chides Junior, but Bob and Larry as well, who Kool-Aid Man themselves right through the fourth wall in order to,
And because God always forgives us, we need to forgive others when they hurt our feelings, too.
Well, how many times am I supposed to forgive them?
Bob? Gee, you know, I'm not sure. Well, let's ask QWERTY. Jesus answered, I tell you, not 7 times, but 70 times 7.
Okay, all right. I have to stop everything right here because I have something to say. Kids? Adults! Those who defy age. If somebody in your life hurts your feelings, apologizes, hurts your feelings again in the same way, apologizes again, and then does that 488 more times, you are under no moral obligation to forgive them a 490th time. I'm gonna be generous and say that the healthy cutoff point is about 20. If they are doing this for the 20th time, that is officially no longer a mistake, it is a pattern of behavior, and it is officially no longer your problem to forgive, but their problem to solve on their own time. Now, I understand what this is trying to say, which is that we need to allow our fellow humans the space to grow and learn from their mistakes rather than instantly canceling them the moment they mess up. Mistakes and hurt feelings are inevitable because humans are not perfect, and so we have a social script of apology and forgiveness. That is a good thing to teach kids. I, Aaron Lockman, am pro-forgiveness. That is my official stance. However, it is also important to teach children how to have boundaries, and that is what this VeggieTalesian model of forgiveness neglects to mention. As I've grown into an adult, my ideas about what forgiveness even is have changed a great deal. I've hurt people, and I've had people hurt me, and in both instances, a conversational exchange where somebody apologized, while important, rarely led to a long-term peace between the parties. In the cases where I hurt people, the only thing that let me move on was working on my problems with a therapist and attempting to become a less hurtful person. And in the cases where somebody hurt me, the only thing that brought peace was a clear set of boundaries. And I've come to believe that forgiveness is an internal process rather than an external one, and that the only true apology is changed behavior. Or, in the words of another beloved animated character,
you can't keep doing shitty things and then feel bad about yourself like that makes it okay. You need to be better.
Now, to be clear, I am not saying that children should watch BoJack Horseman. They should not. The point is that, in my opinion, many of the models of forgiveness we are taught as children are simplistic at best and transactional at worst. Person A messes up, person B gets hurt, person A apologizes, person B forgives. It's a paradigm that, to be fair, a lot of children's media drilled into my head throughout childhood. VeggieTales is not the worst offender by a long shot. But BoJack Horseman is one of a few pieces of media that demonstrates the more complex model of forgiveness that I've come to understand over the last few years. The only other one I can think of that's come close is Ted Lasso, which beautifully models both the social script of forgiveness and the reasoning behind it.
I'm sorry. I shouldn't have done that.
Thanks.
What are you saying sorry to him for?
Being accountable matters, Jamie.
But again, both of those shows are very much for adults. When children's media talks about forgiveness, it gets dumbed down. And while you could very easily make the argument that, hey, you know, calm down, Aaron, it has to be dumbed down because it's for kids. Children are often smarter than we give them credit for and deserve media that treats them as intelligent thinkers. Do the grapes of wrath deserve forgiveness? I don't know. The words deserve and forgiveness are nebulous, vague, and only minimally applicable to real life as I have experienced it. To me, the more important question is, have the grapes of wrath learned from their mistakes? Are they going to improve themselves moving forward? And it seems like the answer is yes. Maybe? They promise to be nice, rebrand themselves as the Grapes of Math, and drive off into the sunset in their car that definitely needs to be checked out by a mechanic because it is making some concerning noises. How long will it be until the grapes stumble into some other kid's front yard and call them a slur? Only time in the tabloids will tell. Moving on! Instead of a silly song with Larry, as the convention of one silly song per episode has not yet been established, we get a silly infomercial. Swindling Scallion Number One tries to sell us the Forgive-O-Matic as a surefire way to atone for all our sins, and Junior Asparagus absolutely reads him for filth. The anti-consumerist message here is unsubtle and not particularly humorous in my opinion, but I certainly agree. Most companies would have you believe that their product is the solution to all your interpersonal problems, and this is, to use the technical term, a crock of shit. And then we have Larry's Lagoon, a parody of the popular 1960s sitcom Gilligan's Island. Bob and Larry run a boat together, and Larry starts daydreaming behind the wheel of said boat, crashing it and stranding himself, Bob, and their three passengers on a desert island. Bob is understandably miffed about all of this, but oh my god, I cannot stress how much I do not care about this conflict. Larry, for his part, gives a really half-assed apology that sounds like a question.
I'm sorry?
And then spends the rest of the short going, I said I was sorry.
I said I was sorry.
Which is a phrase that I hate because it implies that the act of apologizing is all that matters. Bob, meanwhile, is angry at first, but then he just kinda instantly forgives Larry the moment he remembers that empathy exists.
Boy, if I said I was sorry for doing something wrong and really meant it, and people still wouldn't forgive me, I'd feel just terrible.
Oh yeah, definitely.
And then they just kiss and make up without any sort of discussion about how we are going to guarantee that Larry does not crash the ship again, because the professor won't always be there to make a bamboo helicopter. And by the way, this line right here?
It's a big responsibility. You won't daydream, will ya?
Pretty heavily implies that Larry has fallen asleep at the wheel before and may do so again.
Hey, Bob?
Yeah, Larry?
Next summer, let's just eliminate. Like everyone else.
That sounds like a good idea.
Does it? Does it, Bob? Are you sure you want to run so much as a lemonade stand with this man? Also, where does the lemonade come from? There's lemons in VeggieTales. We meet a lemon. Where are you gonna get the lemonade, Bob? Point is, it's the same simplistic paradigm that motivated the previous short. It's forgiveness as a perfunctory back-and-forth exchange. It's the same type of logic that motivates parents to calm down their squabbling children by going, Billy, say sorry to your brother.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Johnny, do you forgive your brother?
Ugh, yeah. Fine.
Great! Now can you two be quiet? Mommy's had a very long day at work and she needs another glass of sloppy juice before she fires up the Hitachi.
And I don't like it.
The things I like about this episode are as follows. Every single interaction between the millionaire and his wife.
I wonder where the skipper is.
Who?
Oh, you know, dear, the bright red round fellow.
Oh, yes. Where is he anyway?
I don't know. That's what I was wondering.
Oh, I see.
They're just so dumb.
And they're so perfect for each other.
The fact that Larry thinks the best way to free whales trapped in an iceberg is to ram his ship directly into the iceberg where the whales are. Larry's cute little raft that he propels by blowing on the sail, which super doesn't seem like how sails work, but I don't know enough about boats to dispute it. And of course, the forgiveness song, which slaps. It slaps so fucking hard, it slaps harder than Mommy's Hitachi. The voice of this palm tree is Jeff Morrow, who's an accomplished singer, composer, and actor, and technically the first voiceover talent that Big Idea actually hired. The accent he's directed to do here is perhaps a tad racist.
Hey man, it is the only way to live.
But his vocal performance is fantastic, the song slaps, and Heineke's instrumentation is on point. Also, I just love the way the coconuts chime in with the lyrics in harmony, and they're singing in harmony. That's cute, that's clever. Also, if you were wondering, Some Veggies Went to Sea does not slap. The Grapes of Wrath slaps, but mostly because Kurt Heineke was allowed to go absolutely nuts with the percussion. But beyond that, I don't find this one particularly entertaining overall. And in my observation, it's not particularly treasured by the rest of the Veggie fandom either. God Wants Me to Forgive Them stands overshadowed on either side by the first ever Veggie Tale and the iconic and widely beloved Are You My Neighbor coming up next. So to be fair, this episode is in a thankless position. It has all the growing pains of Where's God When I'm Scared, with the additional unpleasant task of proving that this project does indeed, and forgive the pun here, have legs.
If you see someone who's hurt or in need, maybe it's time to perform a good deed.
We begin with the tale of Flibber-O-Loo, the rare VeggieTales foray into the New Testament. Apparently, when Phil Vischer was originally creating the show, his mother, who has a PhD in Christian education, gave him the rule that he could not portray Jesus as a vegetable, which obviously rules out a good portion of the most Jesus-y section of the Christian Bible. This is way too phallic. I'm immediately regretting my choice of prop for this section. Incidentally, if Jesus were a vegetable, he would be an avocado because he was brown and American conservatives get way more fucking riled up about him than they need to be. In a funny twist, I think the prevalence of stories from the Old Testament is basically the reason why my Jewish-ass parents let me watch VeggieTales in the first place. The Tale of Flibber-O-Loo adapts Jesus's parable of the Good Samaritan, and it's an absolute delight. The entire thing is written in Susian verse, which is actually very difficult to write well. It's the rhythm and not the rhyming that usually trips people up, but this story, written by Phil Vischer, absolutely nails it. The meter is consistent enough to be pleasing to the ear, but also varies just enough to avoid becoming sing-songy. Anyway, Larry lives in a town called Flibber-O-Loo, where everyone wears shoes on their heads and wages a daily war against the neighboring town Gibberty Lot, where everyone wears pots. One day, Larry goes for a walk and gets mugged and left for dead. These two bitches from Flibber-O-Loo show up, but instead of helping their countrymen, they sing about how busy they are.
We'd love to help, but we can't!
You just did a whole musical number. You have time. This song slaps, by the way. Anyway, Junior shows up, and even though he's from Gibberty Lot and has a pot on his head, he helps Larry out anyway, cause he's not a little bitch. The assembled cast sings another banger in which we learn the stated moral, which is that just because somebody belongs to your perceived outgroup does not mean they're a bad person and you should help them out when you can. In conclusion, just give money to homeless people, alright? You can spare $5 and they are definitionally having a worse day than you are. I really like this story. As I've said, the verse is concise and cleverly done, and the visual design is pleasantly simple and Seussian. I'm especially a fan of the mayor and the doctor's outfits. It's great stuff. Apparently the inspiration for the shoes on the head was the Terry Gilliam film Brazil, which you can totally see in the doctor's hat. And I love it as an absurd little design touch. As for the moral, yeah, I agree with this one, and I would show it to a child with no reservations. The Good Samaritan is such a famous parable that it's entered the modern lexicon as just a phrase to describe someone who's selfless or generous. As a result, people forget that the word Samaritan refers to an ethnic group in ancient Israel that was often at violent odds with the Jewish audience that Jesus was talking to. There's an obvious anti-racist message to be found here, one that did not go unnoticed by many historical Black Christian preachers, including most notably Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And I'm actually gonna quote him briefly because he beautifully expresses the one tiny qualm I have with this story. On the one hand, we are called to play the Good Samaritan on life's roadside, but that will be only an initial act. One day, we must come to see that the whole Jericho Road must be transformed, so that men and women will not be constantly beaten and robbed as they make their journey on life's highway. True compassion is more than flinging a coin to a beggar. It is not haphazard and superficial. It comes to see that an edifice which produces beggars needs restructuring. This is your weekly reminder that Martin Luther King was a lot more revolutionary and uncomfortable than he is often remembered in the white imagination. Moving on! And then, of course, we have the quintessential silly song with Larry, the hairbrush song. This one is iconic. It's iconic. I don't even know if I have the heart to analyze it at length. It deserves every ounce of adulation that's been heaped upon it over the last 3 decades. It's delightfully odd and perfectly exemplifies that brand of bizarre yet straight-laced humor that characterizes much early VeggieTales. It's obviously making fun of opera, but the influence I see most of all is some of the earliest Monty Python songs. TLDR, hairbrush song slaps. Last up we have The Gourds Must Be Crazy. This one is a Star Trek parody, but it takes its title from a 1980 comedy film, which largely stars a character from a tribe of bushmen in the Kalahari Desert who are living quite happily removed from what we would call civilization. The film's humor, intentionally or not, plays off the audience's expectations of tribal Africans and the resulting culture clash when the two worlds collide. I don't think the Big Idea writers had these themes in mind. Rather, it's more likely that this is just supposed to be a cute reference for the parents. But I still find this connection interesting in the context of this short's opening scene. Junior and Dad Asparagus are having a conversation at bedtime about who to invite to Junior's birthday party. And Daddy Asparagus, Dad Asparagus brings up Junior's classmate, Fernando. And Junior responds by being pretty racist, albeit in that innocent kid sort of way, where he clearly has no idea the ramifications of what he's saying.
Besides, he talks kind of funny.
Now, Junior, he doesn't talk funny. He just talks different. His family is from another country.
Yeah, I know. It still sounds funny.
And that's really interesting. The ways in which children hurt each other's feelings are often way more political than they or even the adults around them realize. Anyway, Dad tries to gently nudge Junior away from this line of thinking and bids him goodnight. Instead of crashing through the ceiling this time, Bob and Larry arrive via miniaturized spaceship. Their vessel, the USS Apple Pies, is in grave danger of an asteroid impact, and Junior is the only one who can help.
Didn't you minor in aerospace technology at the Happy Tots preschool?
Why, yes! Yes, I did!
What'd you major in?
That's not important now.
Play-Doh.
Me too.
I love that joke. Also, Junior, while you're putting your degree to use, could you maybe design Bob a better space helmet? This one is making me very anxious. Anyways, they arrive at the ship and meet the chief engineer, a Scottish carrot named Scooter, who informs them that the meteorite endangering the ship is made out of, popcorn?
There's no hero quite like Larry Boy.
Okay, yeah, I'm not touching that. Anyway, Junior spots the titular Gourds, Jimmy and Jerry, over in the corner, and wonders if they can help.
What? Not the new guys! They don't know anything! All they do is sing and eat! Eat and sing!
Oh, so you're saying they're the coolest guys on the ship?
You're saying they're just the raddest dudes ever? I'm sorry, I just feel personally attacked by this. Junior, perhaps internalizing his dad's advice from earlier, strikes up a conversation with these two absolute legends and learns that they are enthusiastic and prolific eaters. So in a great scene with lots of dark dramatic music and flashing lights, Junior directs the crew to throw Jimmy and Jerry in the escape pods and shoot them right at the popcorn meteorite. Hilariously, judging from the dialogue throughout the whole sequence, nobody explain to the Gourds what's going on, but they're just both super chill guys who are just more than willing to roll with it?
Hey, it's kind of like a field trip or something.
Anyway, the Gourds successfully eat the entire meteorite. Jerry discovers the ship is adrift because one cord is unplugged. A+ ship design, no notes. And everyone sings the absolute banger, "I Can Be Your Friend." A celebration of differences and an encouragement to children to extend kindness to all people, even people who seem weird. And I like it. As for the moral, to me, this idea of embracing differences kind of encapsulates one of the primary appeals of friendship. While it's important to find friends with whom you have common interests and ideals, too much commonality kind of gets boring after a while. I want friends who are weird and strange and who I maybe don't understand 100% of the time. I want people who will support me, but also challenge my preconceived notions and make me think more complexly about the world. By the end of the short, Junior has internalized the idea that his classmate Fernando might be a cool person to hang out with specifically because he is, quote unquote, weird and different. And I like Hot Daddy Asparagus's point here, which specifically argues against interpreting the text too literally.
Or maybe if the slime monster shows up and tries to squirt slime all over us, Fernando could maybe blast him with his X-ray eyes.
Well, I don't think Fernando could do those kinds of things. But I bet he could teach you about his country and show you the kinds of foods he likes to eat?
Right! You could learn a lot from somebody with a different racial or cultural background, not just because their skills could benefit you somehow, but because they might just be a cool person! Additionally, this reading could apply to any number of identities a kid might encounter at school. Classmates who are neurodivergent, or gender nonconforming, or physically disabled, just to name a few. And that's a dope message! It's a message that echoes that of the tale of Flibberoloo, but also puts it in a context that's a bit more child palatable. This is a positive thing to note about VeggieTales that are split into two stories. The best pairings not only contrast in tone, but also come at the same issue from two different angles. Keep that in mind as we move forward. Overall, Are You My Neighbor is a classic for a reason. VeggieTales is really starting to get in its groove with a great deal of bold confidence on display. Furthermore, as we've seen, the lessons in this one have a great deal more universality than the previous two entries. The conflicts in both of these stories are interpersonal, not religious, and both narratives show elegant solutions to the conflicts that are inspired by God, but not necessarily kickstarted by him, if you will. This is, I think, one of the defining reasons why VeggieTales became so popular in the mainstream, the fact that it often refrained from beating you over the head with its religiosity. This may not always be the case, but patience, my dear, eager viewer. We have only just begun, and it's only gonna get weirder. Rat Shack and Benny is wild. All I really remember about this one is that it scared the ever-loving bejesus out of me when I was a child, but as we've covered, I was a very delicate child. Is it still just as terrifying? Let's give it a watch!
30 minutes later.
Comrade VeggieTales?
So yes, as an adult, it's kind of hard to ignore the anti-capitalist overtones in this one, although I don't think it's intentional. The Bible story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego is obviously set long before capitalism. And similar to the story of Daniel, it's mostly a story about how the Jewish God is superior to all the other gods, and he could kick all the other gods' asses, and he will protect you if you're faithful to him. Basically, a king named Nebuchadnezzar builds a big ol' statue in the desert and orders everyone to bow down to it. When three Jewish kids refuse, he throws them into a fiery furnace, but when he looks inside, he sees them walking around unharmed, along with a fourth figure, who is presumably an angel.
Well, it looks like four guys in there now, and one of them's real shiny.
Nebuchadnezzar forgives them and decrees that anybody who disrespects the Jewish God should be torn limb from limb, which to me speaks less to a genuine change of heart and more to a generally unstable personality, but whatever. However, by setting this story not only in modern times, but in a literal factory, the big idea writers have inadvertently done something very radical. Now, I'm not here to explain Das Kapital to you, but the gist is that capitalism exists to create profit for rich people by exploiting the labor of the working class. And the purpose of consumerism is to make the working class forget how miserable they are by convincing them that products and not social change are the key to their happiness. Now, I don't mean to say that none of this is intentional. This is not the first or last episode to touch on some anti-consumerist themes, and it isn't the last time our favorite ominous zucchini, Mr. Nezzar, will play the role of the evil CEO of capitalism. But I don't think that, like the big idea writers were trying to convince kids to unionize their future workplaces. Why do I think this? Well, because as with most VeggieTales, several characters conveniently state the moral outright.
My mommy always told me to do what's right, to wash behind my ears and try to be polite.
When all their friends were doing things that were wrong, Rackshack and Benny remembered what their parents had taught them, and that God wanted them to do what was right.
The moral of the story is to listen to your parents and don't give in to peer pressure. But that's not what happens in the narrative. Mr. Nezer is pretty explicitly not our hero's peer. He is their boss, and he has institutional power over them, just like your boss has over you. And furthermore, unlike his biblical counterpart, he does some pretty specific CEO things. He tells his workers to eat as many bunnies as they want on their lunch break as a reward for their hard work, the equivalent of throwing your employees a pizza party instead of raising their wages. He makes a giant statue of his product and tells his workers to worship the bunny, bowing down to it and literally singing its praises. That is only a slight exaggeration of what it's like to walk into an Apple store. His right-hand guy, Mr. Lunt, tells an injured worker to get back on the line. If that's not some Amazon shit, I don't know what is. Plus, the opening song, Good Morning, George, is just an entire mood for anyone who has ever worked a shitty job. From workers expressing the vain hope of making enough money to reunite their families, to not getting adequate lunch breaks, to being penalized for arriving 2 minutes late, to decrying the lack of leisure time in your life because your off hours are spent recuperating from your painful workout. Hours. And yes, perhaps your boss cannot actually threaten you with death by furnace, but he does hold the threat of poverty above your head, which can be just as lethal. This is a show about capitalism, and I don't think the writers know it. Completely by accident, we've just watched a show about shaking off the toxic attitudes that capitalism forces onto you and standing up for your goddamn rights.
Stand up, stand up!
Furthermore, the hero of this story is neither Rack, nor Shaq, nor Benny, who basically learned their lesson right in Act 1 after Shaq, like, tells them about one time that his mom sang him a lullaby or some bullshit. They figure their shit out right away and are basically set to coast for the rest of the story. The true hero of this tale is Laura the Carrot, who learns the very important lesson that the only way to improve working conditions is solidarity with your coworkers. Now that's a goddamn moral I can get behind, much more so than just always listen to your parents, because, you know, kids, come here for a second. Don't tell your parents I said this, but your parents are wrong sometimes. This will not be the last instance in VeggieTales of the narrative moral being somewhat at odds with the stated moral, and it will not be the last time I kind of like the narrative moral better. Is Rack, Shaq, and Benny entertaining? Yes. The accidental communist themes are fun, certainly, but the story itself is very tense and satisfying. The entire third act with the flying car chase scene and the drop into the furnace actually had me nervous as an adult, which really explains why I could not handle it as a kid. The dialogue is hokey at times, but the jokes are clever and fun, and the visual style is really improving. The cartoonish and precise movements of the characters work really well for this satirical setting, and they even manage to make the setting of the chocolate factory feel imposing and grandiose. Overall, my impression of this one is ambitious. Rack, Shaq, and Benny tackle some dark subject matter and is by far the most suspenseful entry yet. There are some things that have not aged well, Mr. Lunt's racist accent chief among them, but the unintentional anti-capitalist themes have aged extremely well, making this one of the most enjoyable rewatches. Very briefly, let's go over the songs and whether or not they slap. Good Morning, George. Slaps. Think of Me does not slap. The bunny song, I'm sorry, but it only kinda slaps. The vibe is fun, but it's kinda repetitive. The Dance of the Cucumber slaps. The bunny song, Derogatory Reprise, funnily enough, fucking slaps. And of course, Stand absolutely slaps. Let us move on.
My head only comes to your middle, but I say little guys can do big things too.
We begin begin with one of my favorite countertop openers of all time, and one which launched an entire franchise within the franchise. Larry, feeling insecure and believing that he's not special, dresses up as a superhero called Larry Boy, and I'm sorry, can we just talk about this superhero design? It's legitimately great. It's iconic, it's striking, it has a unique and recognizable silhouette. Edna Mode would be proud.
Knock it!
Anyway, Larry gets himself stuck on the wall, and then stuck on Bob's nose, and then stuck on the floor. And this prompts Bob to tell the story of Dave and the giant pickle in order to boost the self-esteem of his beloved husband, who is just clearly spiraling. Dave, played by Junior Asparagus, is a young shepherd living in ancient Israel whose life sucks because he's very small and his older brothers keep picking on him. Must be rough, buddy. I have no idea what that's like.
Do you remember the time we dipped you in tar and stuck you to the backside of an angry water buffalo?
Hey, I have one of those. Also, can we take a moment to appreciate this line read from Lisa Vischer?
Oh, look. That guy's mine now.
An eternal mood, honestly. Anyway, Dave's brothers go off to fight a war against the Philistines, and he's really sad because he wants to do a war, but he's just too teeny. I actually can't relate to this part. I spent most of my childhood fantasizing about being found too weak and frail for the draft.
I'm terribly sorry, Peter, but I simply can't go to war. I have a delicate constitution and an absolute dump truck ass.
We arrive at the battleground, where the Israelite and Philistine armies are yelling at each other. I absolutely adore the Monty Python pastiche here, not least because it introduces us to the French Peas, who are an A-plus addition to the cast of VeggieTales, and who would go on to be an essential staple anytime Big Idea needed a large number of goofy enemies. Turns out the Philistines have a secret weapon, the titular giant pickle, who goes by Goliath. It's been 2 decades and I still have no idea what on earth this accent is supposed to be.
They told me that you are the children of God.
Are you Russian? Are you Mexican? What's going on, dude?
But he's a mean, green fighting machine, and the Israelites simply cannot keep it together.
When Dave shows up with some pizza for his brothers, he notices that everyone is cowering in their tents so they don't have to fight the pickle. And Dave is just like, I'll do it. What could go wrong?
And I come at you not with sticks, but in the name of the God of Israel, who this day shall help me defeat you!
As we conclude the first installment of Does VeggieTales Hold Up, it behooves me to discuss how exactly I am going to treat the text of these Bible stories. There are 2 things that I would like to avoid doing with this series. 1, engage in too much literalism. And 2, project too much of my modern moral framework onto this ancient text. Let me speak to each of these. Number 1, so much casual YouTube criticism has become just infuriatingly focused on internal logic and plot holes over theme, character, structure, or anything that actually matters. So I'm just gonna put this out there. This is my ethos. Internal logic only matters insofar as it helps to establish the emotional or thematic truth of a story. And plot holes are both just kinda inescapable and not as big a deal as you generally think. I joke about the many cannibalistic implications of certain foodstuffs existing in the VeggieTales universe, but I hope I've made it clear that that's not what I actually care about. But if we were doing an overly literal, plot hole focused analysis of this story, there are certainly some questions we could ask about this setup. Why is this war being fought like a one-on-one boxing match? You have armies, are you just not gonna use them? Who are the Philistines? Where did they come from? Why do they want to enslave us? And while we're at it, I'm kinda with Dave's brothers on the whole who's gonna fight the pickle question. I wouldn't fight the pickle. I would probably die. I will never care about my country enough to fight the pickle. I mean, I'd eat the pickle. God, I could go for a pickle right now. Is this VeggieTale promoting violence to our children? I'd like to speak to your manager. Now, if you're anything like me, these questions have filled you with an incandescent rage, and you want to just grab me by the lapels and be like, no, 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 sweet boy, just shut up. That's not how media criticism works. And I agree, the giant pickle is not a literal Philistine soldier. He is a general metaphor for adversity meant to illustrate the moral of this VeggieTale. But like all of you, I have been personally damaged by CinemaSins. My brain often goes goes to those places without my consent, and so I have to quell the tiny little cinema sins in my head if I want to do any actual grappling with the structure or themes of a story. Which sucks, but at the same time, I don't want to disregard the weirdness of the original Bible stories. Because I think that examining that strangeness and its historical context is helpful to our analysis. Which brings me to point number two. Dave and the Giant Pickle actually hews pretty close to the Bible story of David and Goliath as written in 1 Samuel 17. The only real addition is the through line of Dave resenting that he's so gosh darn tiny and his brothers being dicks. The Philistines are just as cartoonishly evil, and Goliath is just as cartoonishly big and scary, to the point that different translations from the original Hebrew cannot agree on how tall he's supposed to be. So why is this important? Well, it's because the Hebrew Bible is also propaganda, in a sense. The Hebrew Bible was written by many different Jews over a very long period of time, most of whom lived in the area now known as Israel. It benefited these writers to make their enemies look cartoonish and evil, and to give their heroes fun and kick-ass superpowers that come from God. Now, to be clear, I am not a historian, nor am I a biblical scholar. I'm literally just some fucking dude with a mustache who enjoys diving headfirst down Wikipedia rabbit holes. This is my observation as a person who had not read most of these stories before researching this video. And in an ironic twist, because VeggieTales spend so much of its time in the Hebrew Bible, or the Old Testament if you want to get all Christian about it, this deep dive into a piece of Christian propaganda has turned into a surprisingly insightful journey through ancient Jewish propaganda and the history of my own culture, which is pretty fucking cool. Now, because I know the comments are gonna be a shit show, I am not trying to say that the Hebrew Bible is bad, actually. I want to avoid pointing and laughing at problematic plot points that may be offensive to my modern moral sensibilities. That is usually a very shallow method of analysis, especially when you're looking at ancient texts. However, to say that those problematic plot points have had no impact on our current society would be pure folly. I don't know if you heard about this, but religion is actually a pretty kind of huge deal that affects a lot of people's lives. And so I remain very interested in readings of both VeggieTales and its source material that go deeper than simply what the writer was trying to convey. Now, in this case, what Big Idea is trying to convey is a pretty cool message about self-esteem. Dave does not have to be big, strong, traditionally masculine, or even an adult to achieve awesome things, and the people around him who denigrate and undermine him, insulting him in order to make themselves feel better, are not worth listening to. That's a great message. The dialogue in the narrative insists that Dave succeeds because he has the power of God and anime on his side. But an equally valid reading is that Dave, unlike the other Israelites we see, has the imagination to avoid playing Goliath's game on Goliath's terms. Oh, you thought this was a boxing match, Goliath? Psych, bitch! I brought a projectile weapon to the boxing match because I know that you would beat me in a boxing match. By the way, the scoring in this scene is just incredible. Kurt Heinecke is already experimenting with musical motifs, and I like that throughout this episode, the instrument most associated with Dave, a little guy, is just a cute little muted trumpet. That's great. Is there a deeper socio-political reading to be had here? Maybe, but I'm going to hold off for now because I do not think that Big Idea is trying to say anything in particular about these cartoonishly evil bad guys. That will not always be the case, however, so keep that framework in mind moving forward. Very quickly, do the song Slap. I Love My Lips only kinda slaps, but what it lacks in musical intrigue, it more than makes up for in pure comedic genius. And as an adult, I can confirm that this is exactly what therapy is like. Big Things 2 slaps like a motherfucker. It's so goddamn catchy, and the instrumentation, the percussion, that wet bass line, that jazzy muted trumpet, it's so good, words cannot describe. Do yourself a favor, listen to it every time you need to hype yourself up to do something difficult. It'll work every time. As a parting thought, I leave you with two delicious details from the original Bible story that I'm very glad did not make it into this adaptation. First, after David bops Goliath in the head with a rock, he walks up to the corpse, takes the dude's sword, and chops his head off, after which he, like, parades it around like a trophy, which, yeah, no, great. I didn't want to see that in my VeggieTale. I'm glad that was taken out.
And secondly, David spends the entire Bible story referring to Goliath as that uncircumcised Philistine, which is just a hilarious dunk. Like, can you imagine if I tried to put down my modern day haters by being like, ugh, that guy has such an intact penis. Gross. Next time on Does VeggieTales Hold Up? Wonders and befuddlements to wow your very soul and amaze your very eyes. Blueberries the size of tomatoes. Colonialist undertones and overtones. And most horrifyingly of all, Christmas! And also, I made a fucking banging a cappella music video of Oh No, What We Gonna Do? That you can watch if you just go to my fucking Patreon and fucking subscribe for any dollar amount. You get a free music video. What are you not gonna, what are you gonna deprive yourself of a delightfully fun and well put together a cappella music video? One of the best VeggieTales fucking songs of all fucking time? What are you, you're trying to live a miserable life? You're trying to be like, oh, you know, I only have one precious human life. I'm gonna spend it not having fun. I'm gonna just fucking, like, be miserable the whole fucking time. No! No! Treat yourself! Get yourself $1, $5, any fucking amount, doesn't matter, and go over to patreon.com/Sharon Lockman. Kind of muddled it in my mouth there for a second, but the URL's on the screen and in this fucking thing, it's in my pants, I guess, because I'm pointing that, is fucking, is self-explanatory, okay? Like, what the fuck are you doing? What the fuck are you doing with your life? You know? I want to take care of you. I want you to have a good time. I'm afraid the military life was not for me, Peter. I would that I could go defend my country, but I'd rather defend my c***, if you know what I mean. I'm terribly sorry, Peter, but I don't have a patriotic bone in my body. I'm so sorry, Peter, but I can't fight. I can't fight in the war. Why? Well, because I'm Dame Judi Dench. Would that I could go and fight in the war against the Philistines, Father. I just love this look.